线上的贵宾，大家好，大家午安，欢迎各位来到2023新北市智慧城市国际论坛。我是今天的主持人 Rebecca 佩硕，非常开心这一次是经过一个线上论坛的形式和各位同参与这一次的国际盛会。 Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 2023 NTPC International Smart City Forum. I'm your MC today, my name is Rebecca. In the very beginning, we'd like to welcome some of our honorable guests who are joining us online right now, including our delegations from the British office and also from the Embassy of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. 那我们当然呢，在一开始要先欢迎一下，除了我们在线上参与的贵宾之外呢，现在还有很多像是英国在台办事处的贵宾，还有圣文森以及格瑞纳丁驻华大使馆的贵宾都在线上参与。当然还有呢，我们其他的驻台办事处以及相关工协会的贵宾，现在都已经在线上跟我们一起共同来加入今天的这样智慧城市的国际论坛。那我们呢，在今天一开始呢，提醒一下各位，如果说需要选择语言的话呢，可以在我们 WebEx 的这个视窗左下角有一个地球图形，可以选择我们中文或英文的语言。那 in the very beginning, I would like to kindly remind you that you can select your preferred language by clicking on the Earth iconon the very bottom of the WebEx window. You may select Chinese or English for the whole forum. 那新北市政府呢，是常年非常致力于我们智慧城市的发展，将创新科技应用在我们日常生活当中，同时呢，也持续和世界来展开对话，积极的跟国际上面的智慧城市当中的像产学研各界呢代表来互相交流，共同探讨智慧城市以及永续治理的面向。所以在今天呢，我们在论坛当中呢，邀请到很多国内外的这个学者、贵宾、专家来到现场，还有在线上呢，也跟各位进行分享，所以千万不要错过。那另外呢，新北市政府在今天呢，更是加码寄出了线上抽好礼的活动，所以如果你有报名参加的话，现在赶快上线，也可以赶快告诉你的这个好朋友们，现在都上线加入我们今天的2023新北市智慧城市国际论坛马上开始，待会也会在线上呢抽好礼。那我们在今天论坛的一开始呢，就带各位一同来欣赏这一支开场影片，是我们2023新北市智慧城市的全球肯定片。Now I would like to show you the opening video of today's 2023 NTPC International Smart City Forum. 我们请欣赏。
I'm pleased to announce winners of the 2019 IDC Smart City Asia Pacific Award.
2022 Associo Digital Government Award goes to
ICF Top 1 the Intelligent.
The winner of the 2023 Go Smart Award is
New Taipei City, Taiwan.
The significance of creating a smart city is not just about deploying technology for its citizens' convenience. It's about using inclusive and innovative technologies to create an intelligent community that will ensure the sustainable and resilient coexistence between humans and nature. Particularly in New Taipei City, where culture and technology are brought together, we see endless possibilities for its future.I want to thank and congratulate New Taipei City for showing the world a new model of a smart city and intelligent community.
一双手能创造很多事，可以描绘智慧的蓝图，可以埋下勇气的种子，可以推开世界的大门。我希望能够用我们的双手，专注于每一件生活中的小事。让再日常不过的轻轻一指，成就世界所趋一指的新北市。
好的，我们新北市呢是秉持以人为本，专注于做好每一件生活当中的小事，而以智慧为底，打造一个安居乐业的永续之城。同时呢，也接轨国际，我们展现我们新北市智慧城市治理的成果，也荣获了国际上面各大奖项的殊荣。所以在今天我们论坛的一开始呢，就让我们邀请主办方新北市政府刘和然副市长来为各位致辞，让我们欢迎刘副市长。
各位贵宾，大家好。我是新北市副市长刘和然，非常开心今天以线上的方式邀请各位好朋友来参加2023年新北市智慧城市国际论坛。2023年办的这一场是我们的第四年举办，主要是要让全世界看到新北市在智慧发展的整个愿景以及我们的数位的能量。非常谢谢今天有很多的好朋友一起参加，特别感谢到我们ICF 的主席，同时也是我们的联合创办人 John， 一起来分享他多年推动智慧城市的专业经验以及他的愿景。同时也谢谢很多城市的这个好朋友一起参与，我们加拿大德伦区的主席，我们澳大利亚阳光海岸的市长，以及美国都柏林的市长一起来参与。同时也有很多我们驻台代表处的好朋友以及在企业的精英来分享我们智慧城市的推动。我想新北市在台湾是一个最大的城市，我们很期待的用各种方法把智慧城市落实在我们的市政中，所以在新北市的推动里面，我们是以我们的研考会当作我们的中心。这个研考会里面负责我们大数据，当然它同时也做我们的智慧灯杆的整个部件的一个作业，那它将会是我们新北市在决策的一个大脑，利用我们的大数据中心结合我们智慧共感的整个布局，让我们新北市所有市政在推动跟决策的品质是逐步的提升的。譬如说我们的智慧共感的部件，首先就先用我们市政府所在地的周边开始做第一波的智慧共感的布局，接下来在我们的新开发区，我们很多的都市计划重划区的特殊路段，我们也布置了我们的第二波。当然我们未来最大的目标就是希望全市都有 5G 的智慧共感，利用我们的共感里面的很多的 sensor 可以知道一下我们目前的交通状况、空气品质，当然我们的智慧照明还有人车的分流的辨识，这些在在的讯息都会传到我们的大智慧中心，作为我们市政府推动我们所有市政，当然提供我们所有这个市民最好的一个生活品质。那第二个部分就是结合各局处来推动我们的 AI 技术应用到各局处的业务推动，譬如说我们的经发局，我们的招商特别在林口跟我们的土城地区把 AI 的技术放到我们的这个智慧城市的规划，在智慧城市规划里面，经济的一些发展、产业的一些进步都可以用 AI 技术来做一些智慧园区的控管，让我们的产业逐步的升级。再来是我们的基础教育部分，我们结合了台师大四所大学，所以我们有大学的教授加入，同时把新北市跟邻近台北市的种子教师以及志高的一些工程师一起加进来，做我们微课程的一些编辑，让我们的智慧的相关的议题可以从小就扎根。那第三个部分就是新北市有28个渔港都开始在做推动整个整建，所以我们挑了几个渔港特别作为智能渔港的一个管理，一个渔港如果推共成功，我们就可以让28个渔港都变成一个智能城市一起参与的好伙伴。当然我们知道很多的推动里面还是要回到生活，那环保局天天都是跟我们民众在一起，尤其垃圾车在我们29区穿梭里面，我们不仅有垃圾的处理，当然还有一个是支收物。那支收物以前回到我们的筛选厂其实是很辛苦的，要借我们的人工慢慢的来筛选，那借由我们这次五股垃圾山的整个整治，在最高点的地方我们设置了我们的细筛选厂，目前有5条线利用智慧机器人来做细筛分，同时间可以分类17项的这个制收物。我想对我们的整个生活来讲，尤其我们的环保同仁，他可以做工作上的很多的调配。我想做这么多其实还是回到我们的目的，一个政府的存在就是要让我们的市民朋友过一个好的生活。我想 AI 技术在大家的努力下绝对是现在的一个重点，所以不仅是在我们的决策过程、我们的生活、我们的一些观光，比如到渔港去，我们的支收物回来以后的细筛选都把它融入我们 AI 的技术。新北市非常用心，我们连续4年要办理我们所有的国际论坛，无非是希望很多事情我们要有全球的思考， 当然最后还是在地的落实，也就是所谓的在地实践。非常谢谢 ICF 组织在2022年让我们获得 Top 1，同时也被认证为是一个全方位的一个智能城市。那我们已经办理了世界，明年我们更期待把这样的一个国际论坛更加的扩大。所以我们在这边宣布，明年也就是2024年的6月，我们将跟 ICF 扩大办理我们智慧城市的国际论坛。所有的好朋友还是在邀请各位，可以的话亲自到台湾来走一走，不仅来看看我们整个 AI 技术的提升，同时看看我们智能城市现在落实的情况，还有一个来享受一下我们新北市的大自然。我们是台湾最大的城市，400万的人口，我相信 AI 技术进来一定可以让我们的市民朋友更加的安居乐业。谢谢大家。
好，我们谢谢刘副市长为我们所做的开场致辞。那刚副市长也有提到，明年新北市会成为 ICF 智慧城市论坛还有 Top 7宣布仪式的主办城市，持续的创造和国际智慧城市交流接轨的机会，并且呢将新北市智慧城市的发展成果呢推向世界的舞台。那这一次论坛当中，我们也非常荣幸的邀请到 ICF 主席兼联合创办人 John 来为我们致辞，让我们一起欢迎 John。
On behalf of the Intelligent Community Forum, I'm honored to be participating in the 2023 International Smart City Forum here in New Taipei City. The topic of artificial intelligence is on everyone's mind, especially since ChatGPT came online. But before moving forward with today's topic, what are the challenges and advantages of AI?Now, we understand that there may be job displacement as a result of the deployment of AI, requiring job transitions and the reskilling of some workers. Now, clearly, they are ethical, privacy, and security issues that we have on mind. There could also be technical issues and errors that might occur, especially if the AI is trained on inadequate or biased data sets.And worst case scenario might be where AI systems itself lacks any ability to make moral judgments that humans might make. Now, these are all scary, and in reaction, over 1,000 signatures of scientists and technology and business leaders have signed an open letter asking for guardrails to be placed on any future research and development of AI before it is too late for it to beAn existential threat to the human race. Now, this is, of course, a serious matter, which we will not be covering today. Instead, we will be examining the benefits that already exist through municipalities deploying AI for their communities. So, what are some of these benefits? Now, there are amazing transformations for our cities. We're already seeing automation,removing repetitive tasks that lead to higher productivity and efficiency results. This is because AI can analyze extensive amounts of data quickly, leading to invaluable insights and making informed data-driven decisions. It fosters innovative solutions to complex problems, especially in previously difficult problem-solving areas, such as healthcare, financial services,mobility, and other strategic actions. AI could also help with surveillance, cybersecurity, detection of threats, and support of other safety matters. And it can lead to individual personalization and improved customer service experiences for citizens. So today, responsible municipalities are investigating the AI challenges from security issues,to how best to address traffic management and public safety issues. They undertake collaborative events and processes with experts and stakeholders to understand the implications of deploying the new technology and ensuring that inclusive decision-making has included everyone from government, business, academia, and the community at large.And they ensure that all ethical, privacy, and legal concerns are addressed, especially privatizing citizen engagement. After all of this, communities should strategically invest in robust infrastructure and associated data governance, carefully evaluating all of the benefits, risks, and ethical considerations to establish the right policies and procedures that prioritize their citizens' security, well-being, and overall best interests. So, there's much to unpack today. Later today, I will be presenting an overview of how smart cities and the world are deploying AI to assist in the sustainability of their communities. So, thank you for inviting me. Goodbye.
好，我们谢谢主席 John 为我们带来的致辞。那接下来呢，将会由三个国际智慧城市，包含了像是加拿大德伦区、还有澳大利亚阳光海岸以及美国都柏林市的代表呢，透过影片来和我们针对智慧城市的治理来进行一个国际上的经验分享。那首先呢，将会由加拿大德伦区的 John Henry 主席为我们带来非常精彩的内容，让我们一起欢迎 John。
Thank you for inviting me to the NTPC International Smart City Forum to speak with you about some of the great work happening in Durham region. Durham is a dynamic region with momentum. Located on the east side of the Greater Toronto Area, we are the area's largest geographic municipality. And here in Durham region, we are not just innovating, we're innovating to solve the world's biggest challenges, innovating to create smarter, more connected communities. Our foundation of innovation dates back to early settlement.As immigrants founded local businesses that would grow to be some of the largest and most successful businesses known worldwide, a journey that dates back to the mid-1800s for the automotive industry in Canada. Since 1864, when Robert Sam McLaughlin, the founder of General Motors of Canada, started his journey to transform human mobility, businesses in Durham have committed to improve lives not just for local residents, but for the world.Today, Durham Region's businesses ecosystems support innovators in industries ranging from artificial intelligence and electric and autonomous vehicle mobility to clean tech, agriculture, life sciences, and health. An intelligent community addresses the needs of the community through connection, inclusion, sustainability, engagement, and innovation. Durham Region was named one of the top smart 21 communities of the year for 2023 for the third year in a row.We rank in the top 15 of North American communities, most open cities via Open Data Initiative. And in 2022, we were recognized as one of the top 7 intelligent communities in the world, alongside cities from Australia, Brazil, Canada, New Brunswick, Taiwan, and Vietnam. And we have a bold vision for building smarter, healthier, more equitable and sustainable communities through our region's Intelligent Community Plan. I'd like to take a few minutes to tell you about some of the incredible work happening in Durham.Work that is engaging citizens, improving economic competitiveness, and increasing connectivity. We've been focused on modernizing operations to create a more responsive municipal government to meet the evolving needs of our communities. One modernization project is the My Durham 311 Enterprise. This initiative is aimed at improving Durham's customer service by creating a convenient, omnichannel, and personalized experience for customers, regardless of how they choose to interact with us.We have partnered with Query Inc. to develop and launch the My Durham 311 Smart Home Device Voice Service, an innovative platform where Durham Region residents can interact with their Google Home or Amazon Echo device to find out information about regional services. It's as easy as saying, Hi Google, talk to My Durham 311, or Alexa, open My Durham 311. We were the first regional municipality in Canada to bring regional services to smart home devices.And are proud to have received recognition for this innovative approach to customer service, taking home a Technician and Genius Award and a Smart 50 Award. Then in late 2022, we launched My Durham 311 phone service, enabling customers to only need one phone number, 311, for answers to questions about services like roads and traffic, transit, waste and recycling, water and sewer, and more. This is down from 60 publicly listed phone numbers we had before we launched 311.And most recently, we launched the My Durham 311 Customer Service Portal, an online portal that is accessible 24 hours a day, 7 days a week at mydurham311.ca for residents to submit and track requests for many regional services online. The My Durham 311 Enterprise is transforming how our residents connect with us and access the services they need when it's convenient for them.Durham's smart and connected journey doesn't end there. We can also be found at the forefront of clean energy and next generation automotive industries. Durham Region piloted a first ever autonomous shuttle in Canada that operated as part of our transit system. The WIPI Autonomous Vehicle Electric, or WAVE, was a pilot project to learn more about autonomous technologies and how they could contribute to more sustainable and connected transit operation. Using a zero-emission accessible shuttle with cutting-edge technology, the vehicle could travel up to 20 kilometers per hour with a trained safety attendant on board at all times. Another example of how Durham is finding innovative solutions to common challenges is through road and traffic safety technology. Every day, road users across Durham rely on regional roads to get to their destination safely. In partnership with technology provider Visual Defense, Durham Region is using innovative technology to improve its road patrol program and road repair work using artificial intelligence. Through this partnership, we developed an app called Rover, which is installed on a smartphone that mounts to the windshield of a region's road patrol vehicle. The app automatically detects, identifies, and captures images of potholes using artificial intelligence so that we can fix them more efficiently. Records are then simultaneously transmitted through the cloud for staff to review and process before dispatching repair crews. And all the data is stored in a digital format, making it easy to accurately measure the number of deficiencies on regional roads. This project has won several awards, including the Smart 50 Award from Smart Cities Connect for using AI to optimize road maintenance, a Technology Achievement Award from Transportation Association of Canada, and we were the finalists for the 2023 International Data Corporation Smart Cities North American Award in Transportation Infrastructure. The app is recognized for the end-to-end digital transformation in road maintenance using City Rover AI smart cameras and digital work management. As Durham's population continues to grow, so do the services we provide, and using innovative technology such as Rover will help to improve service delivery. I'd like to thank you again for the opportunity to speak with you today. I look forward to visiting Taiwan in the future and learning more about smart city initiatives. We're working to build a dynamic regional economy that will extend digital connectivity to all of our businesses, organizations, and residents, and support our great quality of life. Thank you.
我们谢谢 John Henry 主席为我们带来的分享。加拿大德伦区呢，致力于用数位治理的方式呢，包含了像是刚刚有讲到在电动车，然后到了科技农业、生命科学，甚至是到了健康照护等这些的领域。那透过了连接、包容，还有永续发展，也鼓励市民来一起积极的参与，还有用创新的方式呢，来满足整个社会的需求。那接下来呢，要为我们分享的就是来自澳大利亚阳光海岸市的 Mark Jamieson 市长。那我们一起。欢迎 Mark Jamieson。
Ni hao, New Taipei City from the Sunshine Coast in Queensland, Australia. I'd like to start by acknowledging the traditional custodians of the Sunshine Coast local government area, whose lands I'm filming this message from for you today. The Kabi Kabi peoples of the coastal plains and northern hinterland, and the Yinnaburra peoples of the southern hinterland.I pay my respects to their elders, past and present, and to all First Nations people. I'd also like to specifically acknowledge the Mayor of New Taipei City and my fellow mayors and city leaders that are at this year's forum. Thank you for the opportunity to participate in the 2023 International Smart City Forum. As Mayor of the Sunshine Coast, I'm delighted to be part of the conversation between like-minded cities who are united in our quest to shape a smarter,cleaner and greener future for our communities. The Smart City program enables Sunshine Coast Council to use technology to deliver services more efficiently to improve the lifestyle of our residents and visitors, while also realising our vision to be Australia's most sustainable region, healthy, smart, creative. A crucial element in the emergence of our region as a smart city is a new heart, the Maroochydore City Centre. This 53 hectare greenfield site just over an hour north of Queensland's capital, Brisbane, and only 10 minutes from the Sunshine Coast Airport, is home to a visionary city centre built from an undeveloped site. The Sunshine Coast also stands as an international site of excellence and an area of natural beauty as a UNESCO Biosphere Reserve, a special place where responsible development and people working, living, and playing sustainably sit alongside active conservation.The United Nations Sustainable Development Goals forms a key part of our planning and is an important foundation of the performance measurement framework of our biosphere. A key focus of our Sunshine Coast Environment and Livability Strategy is to be a low carbon, energy and resource efficient community and realise our target to be a zero net emissions organisation by 2041. We're already making great strides in this area. In 2017, we were the first local government in Australia to build, own and operate our own solar farm. The solar farm financially offsets 100% of our electricity consumption across all our facilities and operations. In 2020, we set up the Caloundra Renewable Energy Facility, capturing the gas from landfill and turning it into electricity. The facility creates enough energy to power 1,200 homes, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We also encourage the use of zero emission vehicles, and we're currently trialling e-scooters and e-bikes in our community to deliver a safe and sustainable service for our people. One of Sunshine Coast's significant achievements as a smart city is the establishment of the Sunshine Coast International Broadband Network. This groundbreaking initiative has catapulted our region to the forefront of connectivity, providing the fastest data and telecommunications connection from the east coast of Australia to Asia, and the second fastest to the United States of America. We now serve as a crucial international gateway, offering an alternative to Sydney and opening doors for new investments, carriers, and increased competition. Additionally, our Testing Tech in Paradise program provides businesses with invaluable opportunities to test and evaluate technologies within our digitally advanced ecosystems. By leveraging the digital network of our Marucci City Centre, we are fostering innovation, creating economic growth, and attracting cutting-edge companies to our shores. Looking ahead, as we prepare to host key venues and sporting events for the Brisbane 2032 Olympic and Paralympic Games, we're committed to leveraging technology to ensure seamless and unforgettable experiences. This will help contribute to our ambitious goal of becoming the world's first carbon-neutral Olympics. It's fantastic to see that our achievements in the realm of smart cities and technologies have not gone unnoticed. The Intelligent Communities Forum has named the Sunshine Coast as a global top seven intelligent community, not once, but four times in the last 5 years. An achievement that New Taipei City are familiar with, having been named the winner of the Intelligent Community of the Year Award in 2022. This recognition is a testament to our unwavering commitment to broadband deployment and use, workforce development, innovation, digital inclusion, and advocacy. Before I hand over to Mr. Ben Vandenberg, who will share more details about our Smart City program, I commend the New Taipei City Government for hosting this forum and for your commitment to strengthening smart technology and sustainability. Thank you, enjoy the summit, and bye-bye.
Ni hao to the Smart City Forum hosts and delegates. Today, I am pleased to be able to share an update on our smart city journey towards creating a sustainable and resilient community. The Sunshine Coast is located about 1 hour drive north of the state capital, Brisbane. Our region features commercial, residential and industrial precincts, as well as open coastline, green belts and pristine hinterland communities. Our current population of 350,000 is projected to grow to more than 550,000 people over the next 20 years. In 2022, we adopted our third Smart City Framework, which now focuses on building enabling digital infrastructure across the entire region and providing data to inform decision-making and improved service delivery. Maroochydore City Centre is being built for the digital century, with extensive use of technology to create a cleaner, greener, more livable, dynamic city centre. Unique features include an underground automated waste collection system, multifunction poles that can be fitted with Wi-Fi, people and vehicle counters, digital and analog signs, environmental sensors, LED lights, and fiber optic cable. Digital touchscreen kiosks that provide wayfinding and real-time information about events, the weather, local history, and public transport. Council-owned telecommunications conduits for multiple carrier access to invest in the region, introduce competition, and increase the number of providers. In today's digital society, being globally connected is more important than ever. The Sunshine Coast now has Australia's fastest data and telecommunications connection to Asia and the second fastest to the United States, thanks to the Sunshine Coast International Broadband Network. The cable connects us with the major capital cities of Brisbane, Sydney and Melbourne, and has brought new investments, new carriers and more competition. As a result, NextDC purchased the cable landing station in 2021 to create the SC1 Edge Data Centre. An open access telecommunications carrier has built the first of two 360 core fibers to be used by seven additional carriers in the region. Our Testing Tech in Paradise program demonstrates how the Sunshine Coast is uniquely positioned to provide the opportunity for companies to test and evaluate technologies before their commercialization. One example is the Connected Worker Trial, which is testing augmented reality wearables and software using Maroochydore City Centre's Wi-Fi 6 network. The Sunshine Coast will be home to four key venues and several sporting events for the Brisbane 2032 Olympic and Paralympic Games. We are piloting human movement and environmental sensors as best practice at the mountain bike track. These include object detection cameras, vibration sensors, and passive infrared sensors to count human movement, such as people, vehicles, bikes, and scooters. The data will show the trends and growth and inform the size of the infrastructure required for our future. Council has been deliberately innovating in the smart city space for the past 8 years. We introduced the Solutions Pipeline online portal to help manage smart city ideas from evaluation through to deployment. Benefits include improved efficiencies in how we deliver services to our community, cost savings, and significantly reduced operational risks. Our results so far are, we have received more than 500 ideas, 242 of these were unique ideas when duplicates were removed. 5 are in the confirm and validate stage, 25 in evaluation stage, 128 potential solutions are in watching brief, 84 solutions have been approved and are operational. This year we published 3 smart infrastructure manual documents, which guide the allocation of digital infrastructure and smart technologies across the region. The manual is aligned with Council's Regional Economic Development Strategy, Community Strategy, Environment and Livability Strategy, and Corporate Plan to achieve regional outcomes. Significantly, we have moved from choosing smart city solutions on an ad hoc basis to the Smart Infrastructure Manual to purposefully plan where smart technologies are mandatory, optional, and location-based. In addition, all our capital works projects are now deploying digital infrastructure at scale. Intelligent government is built on data-driven decision-making. We have a comprehensive system of real-time and historical counting that is available for all council staff to use and inform the way we operate. In turn, we can use this information to determine strategy directions and policy settings, improve service delivery, prioritise our investments, enhance the community experience, and make our region more sustainable. Thank you for the opportunity to present how Sunshine Coast Council is incorporating smart city technologies across our region to deliver more efficient and sustainable services to our communities.
好，我们谢谢来自阳光海岸市我们带来的分享。我想 Sunshine Coast 呢是透过了太阳能的再生能源，还有像是零排放车辆以及国际的宽频网络的系统，目标可以打造一个低碳能源跟资源都高效利用的一个社区。特别是在数位网络的部分，展望2032年即将举办的布里斯本奥运以及帕运会的时候呢，运用科技确保每一场赛事都为各位带来一个难忘的经验。那接下来呢，我们就要欢迎来自美国都柏林市的 Jane Fox 市长为我们带来分享。Welcome, Mayor Jane Fox.
Hello to New Taipei City. I'm Jane Fox, Mayor of Dublin, Ohio, USA. Last year, I had the wonderful pleasure of meeting the delegation from Taiwan when Dublin, Ohio hosted the Global Summit for the Intelligent Community Forum. One of the highlights of the summit was the designation of Ohio as the world's first intelligent state. Another extremely impressive highlight was the crowning of New Taipei City as the 2022 Intelligent Community of the Year. In Dublin, as in New Taipei City, we have embraced the 6 factors of the Intelligent Community Forum: broadband connectivity, sustainability, knowledge work, digital inclusion, innovation, and most importantly, community engagement. Dublin has been honored to make the ICF Smart 21 list 4 times and has twice been named a top 7 intelligent community. Dublin is home to nearly 50,000 residents, more than 4,000 businesses, 64 parks, and more than 150 miles of shared use bike and walking paths. More than 70,000 people work in our city, making Dublin the 2nd largest employment center in Central Ohio. We are ranked the number 1 small city in Ohio and one of the safest cities in America. These are wonderful accolades to receive, but we believe that our most important measurements come from our citizens. The City of Dublin regularly surveys our residents to measure their satisfaction levels, chart any changes in their satisfaction, and then we use their comments to improve the quality of life in our community. In the 2022 Community Attitude Survey, 99% of our residents said that Dublin is an excellent or a good place to live. Satisfaction with daily city services continues to remain high, particularly in the areas of trash recycling services, police protection, city-sponsored events, and snow removal. Each of these are fundamental daily services, and they are supported with modern technology that is real-time and user-friendly. Each year at Dublin City Council's retreat, we discuss our goals for the city, determining which ones have been met and which ones we want to continue to strive to attain. In February 2020, we established a goal to develop a visionary framework to lead our efforts through the next decade and beyond. And as a result of these discussions, Dublin City Council adopted a new vision to be a global city of choice that is the most sustainable, the most connected, and the most resilient. We reinforced that vision with the supporting themes of economics, quality of life, land use, and the environment, and infrastructure. Dublin has a long history of thinking ahead. We have developed numerous strategic plans through the years to serve resident and employee needs through all the aspects of municipal government. And this thoughtful planning has led to the vibrant historic district and the exciting new Bridge Street District, which are woven together by the internationally recognized Dublin Link pedestrian bridge spanning the Scioto River. Those of you who were in Dublin last year may remember actually walking across that bridge. These are just two of several versatile districts that unite a proud history with an exuberant and innovative future. Our city's mission statement says, "We are and always have been a proud local democracy. In our service, we strive to provide the best quality of life and environment in which our residents and businesses can thrive. We seek to ally our proud traditions with the best innovations of the future. To carry out our mission and achieve our goals of being the most connected, the most sustainable, and the most resilient, we have implemented many exciting and forward-thinking programs. The ICF studies and promotes the best practices of the world's intelligent communities as they adapt to the new demands and seize the opportunities presented by broadband and digital technology. As previously mentioned, one of the success drivers of an intelligent community is digital inclusion. Our citizen survey revealed a strong desire from residents for improved access to higher internet speeds. They wanted lower cost and better customer service. And as part of our goal to be the most connected city and to be more inclusive, Dublin is partnering with a private company, Alta Fiber, to provide competitive access to internet service at 10 gigabits to the homes of all Dublin residents. Alta Fiber will be investing approximately $35 million in this fiber optic network. And additionally, the company will provide tech infrastructure, which could include a city innovation center or public Wi-Fi initiatives. Construction of this 10 gig fiber network is expected to be substantially completed within 3 years. This will make Dublin the first completed high-speed fiber broadband service area of comparable size in the Central Ohio region. This undertaking, coupled with Dublink, our 100 gig fiber optic network available to our Dublin businesses, will make Dublin one of the most fiber connected cities in the US. Dublin has also partnered with other entities in the region to create the world's most connected highway. The Route 33 Smart Mobility Corridor is the result of multiple organizations and government entities coming together. They're supporting intelligent innovation, and it's aimed at saving lives and improving the way we work, the way we live, and the way we travel. With a 35-mile redundant loop of fiber connectivity, the 33 Smart Mobility Corridor includes 432 strands of fiber, 63 roadside units, and more than 40 connected intersections. The corridor is the backbone of the Beta District, an innovation district encompassing the City of Dublin, the City of Marysville, and Union County, as well as the Marysville Union County Port Authority. It's more than a smart roadway, it's a living lab, where innovators from around the world deploy, test, and evolve pioneering automotive technology in real-world settings. Innovators like Honda, Denso, Dirk, Ease Logistics, Fujitsu, No Traffic, and Share Mobility are working with the City of Dublin and our partners in the Beta District to launch smart mobility ecosystems, test smart parking lots, and deploy tire intelligence and cloud-based logistics. But why do we really do this? Studies have shown that 94% of serious automobile crashes are due to human error. Utilizing vehicle technologies such as these can address 80% of crash scenarios, and it could reduce 26% of crashes. And the technology could prevent 592,000 crashes and save 1,083 lives per year. And then there are the ways in which we stay connected to each other and employ some of the latest technology, including artificial intelligence. The City of Dublin utilizes Zen City, a platform that consolidates online information, reactions, and posts from various online sources, and then uses AI to develop insights on sentiment and trends. It helps us to keep a pulse on the community and to correct any misinformation that may be floating around on social media. We use the information to mitigate rumors, direct people to the correct information, and block bots and fake accounts that sometimes emerge. We receive regular reports that include media mentions, public sentiments, and emerging topics. We also are able to monitor short and long-term events, projects, and situations as they occur. CityBot is another tool we use to expand our use of AI through a chatbot for our website and texting that will make it easier for the public to ask questions, find information, and request services. Chatbots seem to be on everybody's minds these days, and our IT department is investigating utilizing these tools to enhance productivity and combine it with our own staff members' expertise and critical thinking. Now, we recognize that AI tools are not perfect and sometimes provide inconsistent or biased data. As a security measure, employees are cautioned to respect confidentiality and data privacy, as well as to be mindful of the data they input while using discretion. Of course, it's still vital to cite sources of information by letting readers know if a substantial portion is system generated. We also advise using mainstream, reputable tools or ones provided through our own software. We encourage feedback, suggestions, and ideas for optimizing the usage of this new and valuable tool. Our police department, too, is taking advantage of new technology to help keep our city safe. We utilize state-of-the-art geographic crime prediction programs for crime mapping and determining where crimes might occur. The programs take data from more than 10,000 sources, including other jurisdictions and police agencies across the country, resulting in intelligence-led policing to make better decisions. As we advance being a connected community, we emphasize that it's about human connectedness and that people will never be replaced by technology. We in the city value human connections and human relationships and listening to each other to improve our interactions. But connectivity isn't the only area where we want to shine. As I mentioned earlier, the City of Dublin also seeks to be the most sustainable city. Our city was founded in 1810, unlike many of yours. And at that time, those early settlers experienced a pristine setting, and they valued, respected, and cultivated the land they settled. One of our taglines in Dublin is, "It's greener in Dublin." And I'm proud to say we have embraced that since the city's founding. In our city of nearly 25 square miles, you will find more than 1,100 acres of developed parkland, nearly 200 acres of undeveloped parkland ranging from wooded natural areas and river frontage to active athletic facilities. Our future is aimed at being a model for sustainable community design that supports our natural environment. We believe we are here to care for the land and for the people so that everyone can thrive. Our sustainability initiatives include food composting, electronics recycling, prescription pill collections, household hazardous waste drop-offs, and document destruction days, and diverting tons of waste from the landfill each year. Dublin's renowned Irish Festival, which sees 100,000 visitors over a three-day weekend, has a mission to be zero waste and encourages visitors to reduce, to reuse, and to recycle. Our city's fleet routinely lands on the list of the 100 best green fleets by the National Fleet Management Association, earning the number 3 ranking in 2022. And in June this year, our City Council voted to adopt revised zoning code regulations surrounding the use of renewable energy equipment for solar. The city's renewable energy equipment regulations promote sustainable environmental practices and stewardship while balancing the high-quality development standards that define the character of the Dublin community. But sustainability is about so much more than just the environment. It's also about fiscal sustainability. We are setting the conditions so that our city will remain and still be a desirable place to live long after we're gone. And that brings us to resiliency. Everyone's world was rocked by the pandemic, and still we rose. And today, Dublin, Ohio, USA continues to be a safe, resilient, and inclusive city where everyone can thrive physically, mentally, socially, and emotionally. Dublin is a city that provides a multitude of options geared toward the physical well-being of all who live and work here. Dublin is a city that cares and provides for the mental and behavioral well-being of all, and is also a community of lifelong learning and modern educational experience. Dublin is a city that prides itself as the safest place to live and is prepared and resourced to withstand and quickly recover from any crisis or disaster. Dublin is a city where all are welcomed, valued, engaged, and included, regardless of socioeconomic status, race, ethnicity, color, sexual orientation, gender, disability, age, military, or religious status. We believe to be a holistically smart and intelligent community. We must take care of our people, improve their quality of life, and treat them with kindness and respect. If we can do that, then we know we have achieved success. I want to thank New Taipei City for inviting me to join you this morning. I wish you all an exceptionally good conference. We look forward to New Taipei City hosting the 2024 Top 7 Intelligent Communities of the Year announcement next June.
好，我们谢谢 Mayor Jane Fox 为我们所带来的分享。那美国都柏林市呢，以改善网络交通、还有网络安全跟交通安全，还有改善居民的生活为主。像是呢，在交通的十字路口设置摄影机的装置，来确保我们在路口的用路安全，还有一些效率。那另外在 Ohio 中部的 Beta 区呢，也提供数位创新技术的这个测试平台，希望可以打造一个永续全面的共融的城市。那我们也非常感谢以上三位智慧城市的代表今天特别也为我们这个新北市的智慧城市论坛所做的分享，让我们可以接近国际，也期待未来呢新北可以有更多的机会和国际的智慧城市携手合作，一同打造智慧永续之城。那接下来呢，我们马上就要进行到国际交流的环节。我们今天非常荣幸是邀请到加拿大还有奥地利的驻台办代表，跟大家一同讨论关于各国在推动智慧城市的相关经验，还有呢迈向永续发展的一些策略跟布局。那现在就由我为各位呢隆重的介绍今天与会的贵宾。 And now I would like to introduce the moderator and also the panelists of today's panel discussion. 那首先呢，我们先介绍今天的引言人，就是我们勤业中心的许梅君执行副总经理，帮我们跟大家挥挥手。And also would like to introduce the panelists. First of all, please welcome the Deputy Director of Trade and Investment at Canadian Trade Office in Taipei, Mr. Derry McDonnell. Welcome.And also would like to welcome the Director of Austrian Office Taipei, Mr. Roland Rudefer. Welcome. 那接下来我们就把时间交给引言人 Mavis.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Mavis Xu, Executive Deputy General Manager of Deloitte & Touche. It's my honor to be the moderator of the panel. And it's great to see so many people here online to get together who are concerned about the sustainable design of a smart city.And the video earlier showed the experiences and ideas regarding the future development, planning, and the introduction and application of AI in smart city from Durham City in Canada and the different cities. And now, thanks to the effort of the cities mentioned above, the advancement of the technology has opened up new opportunity for urban governance. Our quality of life, administrative efficiency, and overall sustainability.Have also been enhanced with the assistance of technology. Through the video shared earlier, What's interesting is the various smart cities around the world has developed different innovative solutions tailored to their specific needs. However, there are also common ideas toward creating an ideal and livable place for citizens. And it's a privilege to have opportunity to explore the gallery of international sharing, exchanges, and interactions. Through these experiences, we can gather diverse insights and spark ideas, allowing us to envision the future development blueprint of New Taipei City from various perspectives. And New Taipei City has always adhered to the core concept of the human center with technology as aid, and is committed to creating a practical and accessible smart city from a citizen perspective. And the city pursues the vision through five major strategies: smart government, smart economy, smart security, smart life, and a sustainable environment. And to achieve the goal, New Taipei City collaborates with various bureau agencies as well as central and other local governments. And for instance, a centralized big data center has been established to facilitate the transmission of government information and provide government-level decision-making support through effective data management and analysis. And additionally, the city government has launched the vaccination booking system and streamlining and simplifying the vaccine appointment and administration process. The initiatives have successfully improved vaccine coverage among the residents. On the other hand, plans are underway to establish a cybersecurity lab, a smart flood control platform with the goal of enhancing the digital security safety of our citizens. Additionally, the development of Taiwan's 5G, first 5G smart industry park, Baogao, is in progress. Baogao will offer a unique network experimentation area, forcing collaboration not only among international and local cooperation, but also providing support for startups. Moreover, New Taipei City has introduced a mobile payment application called New Taipei, which has been honored with the 2023 Gold Smart Award by issuing New Taipei dollars through this platform. It encourages civic engagement while creating various consumer scenarios and promoting cashless payments. And besides, by promoting a variety of projects, New Taipei City has gradually gained recognition on the international stage. For instance, New Taipei City was awarded the top prizes as the Global Smart City by the International City Forum, ICF, at the year-end 2022. Furthermore, early this year, it became the world's first city to obtain complete smart city certification through the two-stage evaluation process by the ICF. And looking ahead, New Taipei City will continue its journey towards achieving the goal of becoming a sustainable smart city and to combine technology with citizen engagement and international influences to create a resilient and a sustainable smart city. Therefore, New Taipei City very much hopes to have the opportunity to learn from other cities, especially regarding technology application, experience, and sustainable urban planning around the world. Next, it's my honor to welcome our special guest, Mr. Darren McDonnell, and the Deputy Director of Trade and Investment at the Canadian Trade Office in Taipei. Welcome. And Mr. Roland Ludifer, the Director of Australian Office in Taipei, to share their valuable experiences with us. Okay, and first, now the AI technology has adopted a lot in different countries, and it's a very hot topic. And we know that in Canadian, AI security is a high focus. We will be begin within the government. Mm-hmm. And I want to invite Mr. McDonnell to share with us the AI technology and application in Canada mm-hmm. with us. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me to speak today. Not only am I honored to participate myself, but I'm pleased to see important contributions to this conversation being offered by Canadians such as John Lung of the Intelligent Community Forum and John Henry of the Regional Municipality of Durham. And furthermore, on a purely personal level, I'm excited to see the potential that the Smart City movement will have on the lives of my family and I in the future. Of course, I'm aware that what we're talking about will have a street-level impact on the lives of our city's citizens, and it's something that I think about, of course, every time I get on a U-bike or take the MRT here in Taiwan. So yes, I'm happy to share with you a couple of examples, if I may, just short ones, of companies in Canada that are involved in this domain. The first one is TELUS. TELUS is the largest telecommunications provider in Western Canada. It's headquartered in Vancouver. And it's partnered with Google and NXN to make Canadian cities safer, greener, and smarter. In short, TELUS provides an ecosystem of integrated smart technologies that enable cities to improve the lives of their residents under four fundamental pillars. The first is infrastructure and environmental sustainability. The second is intelligent transportation. The third is public safety and security. And the fourth is health, such as smart devices and virtual health care. And as I say, together TELUS, along with Google and NXN, are working together to find smart city solutions that can help reduce carbon emissions and support healthier living.
Yes.
Yeah. The second example I've got is from a company called Envision AI. And they're based in Toronto, Ontario. They're an exciting company. They're a leading provider of video-based AI solutions for transit and public safety applications. And their solutions enable edge devices, such as remote cameras and other sensors in the field, to interpret the world around them without relying on costly hardware or cloud connections. The devices themselves can do the computations. And that increases the speed that they can do them. And Envision AI is deploying these products targeting smart roads, smart cities, and autonomous rail. And they, in fact, have visited Taiwan themselves and have had some discussions with the Taiwan Rail Authority on things like control systems for railway crossings, at level crossings where there are roads. So they're very exciting as well. So these are just some of the things going on in the AI smart city space in Canada.
Okay, thank you for sharing. And I think when we're adopting AI, it will maybe have some concerns or risk that we have to take care. And could you maybe share with us how Canadian government to deal with the AI, the risk, or AI, or how the government maybe have to respond to this situation?
Sure. So I've got a presentation.
Okay.
And I thought it might be helpful to share some thinking on the subject. That was done by our by Canada's Security Intelligence Service, CSIS, and recognizing that the desire of communities to become intelligent, may also make them more vulnerable, CSIS has put together some suggestions which I was hoping to share with you today. So I'll just grab my controller here.
Yes.
So what are smart cities? There are a lot of definitions of a smart city. Here we refer to environments where digital technologies are used to enhance the quality and efficiency of municipal services. And a smart city collects and analyzes data interactions with and the usage of public infrastructure in order to improve service delivery and user experience. And then this data is collected through sensors and individual devices, which are part of centralized networks that manage service delivery. And smart cities can be scalable according to the needs and intentions of the community. And the key factors that shape it are that shape smartness include the quantity and the quality of the data collected, the degree of interaction of different infrastructure networks, and how the data is used to inform decisions by infrastructure owners and operators. Now, with respect to smart cities in Canada, there's no definitive thinking on the number of smart city projects currently underway in Canada, but there's clearly a high level of interest. In 2017, when the Government of Canada Smart Cities Challenge was launched, Over 225 municipalities expressed interest in exploring smart city benefits by submitting applications, and including small towns, indigenous communities, etc., all applied. So what kind of data is collected and how? So to give you a sense of the kind of information that could be collected in a smart city, consider these applications: smart utilities, smart homes, autonomous vehicles, smart hospitals, smart commerce, and smart public transportation. And to provide one example, smart city technologies used to manage traffic or transportation might collect data that provide a picture of individuals' movements in a city and other related data. And this personal information from sensors, such as audio and video recording devices or vehicle license plates, or from personal. So what are the obviously, smart cities represent the next generation of critical infrastructure underpinning nearly all aspects of daily life. And this integrated centrality means that smart cities will be attractive targets of hostile state actors and criminals for espionage, sabotage, and disruption. Smart cities will collect and operate by processing huge volumes of personal and corporate data through interactions with and usage of smart infrastructure. And this data can provide valuable insights for threat actors, including the profiles and patterns of life of individual people. And in the hands of a threat actor, this data can be exploited to enable activities that compromise the safety and security of individuals and public infrastructure. And of course, connecting different critical infrastructure systems via telecommunications networks increases both the attack surface and the potential scale impact of an attack. For example, access to or disruption of one infrastructure system could have spillover effects on other systems. So some of the possible harmful impacts of a smart city breach or inadequate data governance include disruption or denial of access to public infrastructure or services, such as public transit, traffic control, emergency dispatch, or utilities, such as water or electricity. Unauthorized access to, retention of, or exploitation of individuals' personal and corporate data, which could be used to facilitate further targeting of individuals and communities for foreign interference or espionage. Excuse me. And examples here could include capture and misuse of personal information, surveillance footage, disruption, theft, corruption, espionage against targeted communities, harassment, intimidation. And another risk is the use of large amounts of community data to support research for the benefit of foreign states in developing military systems or surveillance programs. So how can smart cities be compromised? Well, through cyber operations, insider threats, compromised equipment or supply chains, or external actor access to systems or data during installation, maintenance, operation, or servicing. So key considerations for smart city adopters. Integrate data governance and security into all phases of a smart city project, from design throughout operation to decommissioning. Next, identify and apply global best practices to ensure the security of endpoints and devices, networks, data, and applications. Next, engage citizens early to ensure awareness and understanding of the privacy and security implications to facilitate meaningful public consultation. And be transparent with citizens about the data being collected in smart cities and the ways it is being used and handled, where it is stored, and how it is protected. Also, do your due diligence. Smart city technology and software vendors and their supply chains should be assessed very carefully to ensure that data access, storage, transfer, and use will take place in a manner and location that protects the safety, security, and privacy of citizens. Of course, review all the data governance and access and storage provisions carefully and seek legal and security guidance before concluding a vendor agreement. And ensure that vendor agreements include clear and enforceable dispute resolution provisions. and conduct privacy and security risk assessments before deploying any smart city applications or platforms, and prepare for and practice critical incident response to ensure a rapid response in the case of incidents such as a data breach or cyber attack. So these are some of the, this is some of the thinking that's been going on by Canada's primary security agency with regards to smart cities and some of the key risks and factors that need to be accounted for, taken into consideration. It's not just about the technology, it's also about the governance.
Yes. Okay.
Thank you.
Mentioned not only technology, we have to maybe focus on the governance. Yeah.
Right.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
And besides, I also want to invite Mr. Rutherford, okay, to share with us how smart city policy and smart application in Vienna or other cities in Austria.
Yeah. Thank you very much for the opportunity to be here today, and. Austria, well, maybe first thing is, I always say, because Austria and Australia
yes.
are very often, there are no kangaroos in Austria, and Austria is in Europe, in
yes.
the heart of Europe, so
yes.
we are very often Austria and Australia are being, yeah.
In Austria, we started very early with strict legislation in all aspects
of air management,
waste management,
yes.
water management,
and energy management. This had also to do with
that we
decided, the Austrian people in a special election decided in
1978 against nuclear
power.
Okay.
So we had to find very early alternatives, and alternative energy has become very important
since
in the Austrian energy infrastructure.
Yes.
So and that at the same time water, air
and waste management
yes.
are also decisive factors for Austria's tourism.
Because the beauty of the landscape to keep everything sustainable and natural as possible, from the tourism point of view
yes.
is amazingly important for Austria, not only the beauty, but also the for the Austrian people and their visitors to sustain all the resources we have. As for example, the air quality in Austria has never been better. Actually,
okay.
in the last 20 years, have had the lowest pollution levels in 2021. The waste management. Contrary to many to many other places, starts actually from top to bottom with waste avoidance. Then the preparation to reuse, to reuse, then recycle, then other waste recovery, and then whatever is left over that will go in a dump or being burned in one of the factories. So we already banned non-biodegradable plastic bags in 2020, and in 2025 all plastic bottles, there will be not a ban on it, but there will be to be paid a deposit for it. So this is all the policy to avoid as much as possible the creation of waste as much as we can. Also, strict laws in water management have led to that 99% of Austria's lakes, rivers, groundwater were classified excellent or good.
So in Austria, we don't
buy, for example, water bottles.
Okay.
We just get
the water everywhere in Austria out of the
tap. So we fill up our water bottles. Of course, you can buy it
also
yes.
in grocery stores, supermarkets,
and
everywhere.
Yes.
But we are used to that we
just drink tap water. We are very lucky with that. Even when you go for a swim in Austria, most lakes and rivers have drinking water quality. So if you get thirsty when swimming, it's just open your mouth. And
yes.
And the energy management in Austria, already 85% of Austria's primary energy are coming from
sustainable and
renewable resources. And so
the basis of this, and especially hydropower, is the biggest one, because we have a lot of water resources, of course, and we use also those water resources to generate power as much as we can. To give you an example, for example, this is the waste burning facility in Vienna, which is very near to the city center. It has even become a work of art.
The outside was designed by
a famous Austrian
artist called Friedensreich Hundertwasser to actually make it locally and socially
acceptable. And it uses the latest environmentally friendly technologies such
as filtering system and so on. And it's not only burning waste, but also
at the same time, it's a power generation factory.
And in the end, it also
became a tourist attraction at the same time.
So those are the basic policies
why Austria, and especially Vienna, is the most livable city nowadays in the world. Every year being number one, two, or three as one of the most livable cities in the world.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Ludefer. Thank you for your sharing. And I think aside AI, sustainability is also a very hot topic in recent years. And I think that Vienna has be a very globally renowned livable and livable city, and with a strong focus on water resources as a key policy area, as you mentioned earlier. Okay, and the government has also devised the Winterwasser 2050 as their strategic plan for Vienna. Okay, and besides, we are very curious about how Vienna utilizes digital data and artificial intelligence to realize the green initiatives and employ innovative technologies to develop water resource supply management and some supply infrastructure. And now I want to invite Mr. Ludefer and to share us the insight with us.
Yeah, I mean, Vienna basically has now, this year, there's 150 years of city water. The water actually comes
from
area, from a mountain area, you get best mountain water in Vienna, and the waterways have already been built through aqueducts more than 150 years ago, and they have been kept and modernized throughout the decades. Okay. For example, we are all the installations, the technical installations, the waterways are being checked with drone technology, so it's not necessary anymore to dispatch teams to personally check and maintain, but by using drone technology and the latest GSR and virtual reality and all those in those cameras, those data and pictures
are then directly transmitted to HQ
and to the concerned technical departments, and they check it actually through drone technology.
Okay.
If there are any damages, if there are any, yes, or anything to maintain, to repair, or to replace. So artificial intelligence,
yes,
is more and more
important in this case.
Yes.
Or in the city of Vienna, through the City of Vienna app, also Vienna, City of Vienna, the water management department also provides drinking fountains all over the city of Vienna, and they are also controlled centrally through technical devices and artificial intelligence, and also through the City of Vienna app, you can find all those cooling places where water vapor is used to cool down the heating up the cities, the city of Vienna, which is heating up every year. So but at the same time it's also very important for Vienna to have those green lungs, public spaces,
yes,
being used more and more to create microclimates in the city of Vienna, to make it more livable and more As an example, here is the old Danube Natural Reserve. And here's an example. This has been this is a shopping road, basically. And trees have been planted, and connecting public transport, electro buses, metro cars, make it accessible for many residents is very important. And for example, also the pricing,
yes.
the pricing, it's only the annual ticket. Without any discounts, now I'm talking without any discounts, would be around 11,000 Taiwan dollar per year. So, with this ticket, you could even go to the neighboring regions of Lower Austria and Burgenland, for example. Mm-hmm. Or this is a road, you see it right now, what it looks right now, and it will be transformed into a new newly transformed for pedestrians, trees green, and also to create a better microclimate. So this will be in 2023. And one of our partners, and being very, very important for us, is one of the companies specializing, especially in hydropower solutions, is Andritz. They are a worldwide leader in power generation through using hydropower, and with each and every in each and every area, from small, medium, large sized power generation installations to even using tidal seawater, and even going into hybrid ones using hydro and solar together, for example. Here are some of the projects which have already been realized here in Taiwan, as an example, and one of the new technology and concepts are also the use of hydrogen and ocean energy from the currents, tidal and ocean waves. In Carinthia, that's in southern Austria, there is a very good place to find out more about green technology, but also we call it our Silicon Valley in Austria, but also this is one of the hearts of sustainable green technology with a lot of companies. And one of the partners worldwide, it's not directly a government agency, but government funded, is the Austria Technology Corporation, which is a great partner for any local and any governments and any local governments to find out more about Austria's smart city, environment, sustainability, DSG in general. So that's what I would like to answer with.
Okay, thank you for the insight, for sharing from Mr. McDonnell and Mr. Rutherford. We learned a lot from the experience in Canada and Austria, and very insightful sharing, and we learned a lot from that. And I think that will help the New Taipei City. We can to plan our future blueprint for the New Taipei City Sustainable Smart City Plan. And thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you too.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, our moderator and our panelists for the very informative panel discussion. 我们谢谢我们驻台办的讲师还有引言人，为我们带来非常精彩的一场这个国际的交流。透过驻台办代表的分享呢，我们也了解到加拿大跟奥地利智慧治理的一些经验，还有我们科技应用在我们绿能永续的这些面向。那我们活动进行到这边呢，也要提醒一下各位贵宾，就是我们今天有线上抽好礼的活动，所以如果今天各位呢实际上登入上线的贵宾呢，就有机会可以获得我们的快充充电器插头加双接口的简报笔一组，所以欢迎大家赶快呼朋引伴的来加入我们线上的论坛。那接下来会有一个休息的时间，请各位在3:25的时候再回到现场。And right now we'll take a short break and please come back here at 3:25 for our next session. Thank you.
I'm pleased to announce
winners of the 2019 IDC Smart City Asia Pacific Award.
2022 Associo Digital Government Award goes to
ICF Top 1 the Intelligent.
The winner of the 2023 Go Smart Award is
New Taipei City, Taiwan.
The significance of creating a smart city is not just about deploying technology for its citizens' convenience. It's about using inclusive and innovative technologies to create an intelligent community that will ensure the sustainable and resilient coexistence between humans and nature. Particularly in New Taipei City, where culture and technology are brought together, we see endless possibilities for its future. I want to thank and congratulate New Taipei City for showing the world a new model of a smart city and intelligent community.
一双手能创造很多事，可以描绘智慧的蓝图，可以埋下勇气的种子，可以推开世界的大门。我希望能够用我们的双手，专注于每一件生活中的小事。让再日常不过的轻轻一指，成就世界所轻一指的新北市。
到就知，无广告，免收费，资安强，新北二代智慧社区 APP。
到扫描，通通智能化。新北二代智慧社区 APP。
公社预约，一键就通。新北二代智慧社区 APP。
就看得到，无广告，免收费，资安强，新北二代智慧社区 APP。
老师，度数八七七八，七八八七还是八七八七八？八七七八。七七八。
哎，洪先
生。哎，帅哥。
你去散步啊？
对啊，设计走一走啊。
好，拜拜。
拜拜。
这样填瓦斯女神轻松。新北二代智慧社区 APP。
大哥，
什么代志？
楼上那个健身房的跑步机坏掉了。
是哦。那无你再给他定一下，好不好？
又一台坏掉
啊！那真嗨，那无你去再搁个电机一下吼。
跑步很好，但用 App 报修更好。新北二代智慧社区 App。
喂，这是1999吗？有一个消防车坏了，我姓洪。
好，欢迎各位回到我们2023新北市智慧城市的国际论坛。那我们在休息之后回到现场呢，马上接着要进行的就是四场专题演讲，分别是针对 AI 趋势科技，还有呢我们智慧城市的创新应用的面向来和各位进行分享。所以首先呢，第一位要欢迎的就是我们 ICF 主席兼联合创办人 John 来为我们进行第一场分享，让我们一起欢迎 John。
On behalf of the Intelligent Community Forum, I'm here today at the 2023 New Taipei City International Smart City Forum. My name is John Young. I'm the chairman and co-founder of the Intelligent Community Forum out of New York City, and I'm here to deal with the topic called Accelerating Smart City and Intelligent Community Development with Artificial Intelligence Technology.So, AI and municipalities is a very important topic. Any discussion around artificial intelligence requires an introduction recognizing the pros and cons of AI, especially in this era of uncertainty swirling around this debatable topic. So on one hand, we're hearing about the existential threat that AI poses. On the other hand, if the risks can be properly managedthrough strict controls and governmental organizations' understanding of its serious negative impacts and agreements on its limitations, artificial intelligence has the potential for much good. So my talk today is really going to focus on how AI could accelerate smart city and intelligent community development. But let's look at some of these principles first.So, by learning from international best practices in technology, particularly AI, to create sustainability, municipalities can improve their efficiency, decision-making, their resilience, access to expertise, and collaborative opportunities, leading what we believe is a more sustainable future for their communities. Now, first of all, improved efficiency. This is one of the areas that all cities would like to have. And it'll be leveraged through AI-enabled data generation and analytics that help to analyze and provide decision-making skills to the different community organizers and so forth. There's machine-to-machine learning that occurs. There's digital twinning and many, many other AI-related technologies that municipalities can optimize in order to reduce waste, create better resources,and increase the efficiency of operations. This can lead to cost savings and more sustainable use of resources. As I said before, better decision making. AI helps municipalities make better decisions about resource allocation, infrastructure development, environmental management, and all of those things leading to a more sustainable outcome and a better quality of life for its residents.It helps in terms of enhanced resilience, access to global expertise, and development of collaboration and partnerships. The best way to learn is to find the sources around the world that have successful solutions and work with them in a collaborative and in a partnership to create a more livable community for yourselves. Today, I'm going to talk about this using cities around the world that the Intelligence Community Forum has ranked as many of its cities or some of the cities that are aspiring to become intelligent communities. There are a group of cities in Europe called the AI for Cities Project. There are six cities: Tallinn, Paris, Stavanger, Amsterdam, Copenhagen, and Helsinki, all of them who are looking for AI-based solutions to accelerate carbon neutrality by reducing CO2 emissions in their energy and mobility domains. Now, Tallinn, for instance, is one of those cities, and they have an AI for Cities project that aims to align various mobility solutions and policies around greenhouse gas emissions reduction targets. Amsterdam is one of those cities that has about 20 or more initiatives right now that are dealing with various agendas around AI technology, but from a people-first perspective. It also has many projects that are infrastructure related, or in this case, AI for green roof management. This is a very high resolution satellite imagery testing and machine learning capability that AI is able to work with and provide open source T-detecting algorithms on a map that helps in terms of green roofs and on the street coverage across the city. Amsterdam has many other projects as well. One is called the Amsterdam for All Project. This looks for access for people using streets and intersections. There's one that deals with homelessness, and AI seeks out poverty detection capabilities. There's one called the Public Eye, which is an AI crowd monitoring system where they're able to manage pedestrian and bicycle and other traffic issues. And of course, these are all things that do have issues around privacy and transparency. And so while they are providing these different projects in these communities, they're also investigating how best to deal with those kinds of privacy issues and so forth. Helsinki is also a AI for Project City. They're looking at agile business environments, and AI helps in terms of that. They have an experimental accelerator where they're able to take ideas using AI to help create new business opportunities. University of Helsinki has a postgraduate degree which aims to develop skills in this area. And they have a register that provides AI as an opportunity for people to better understand what those AI systems and their algorithms are being used for. Again, these cities are very citizen-first focused. Copenhagen, another AI for Cities community. They are interested in becoming the first carbon neutral capital in the world by 2025. Already, they're a leading cycling city, that's for sure. However, they want to do more than just that. They want to develop greenhouse gas information systems, and they have a system that AI is able to help to support. Now, each one of these slides, you'll see there's contact information for more information or a person that you can contact for more information. Barcelona, they are a community that's looking at using AI in social services to help create a long-term structural and cultural sustainability. They have what is known as a recognition of algorithms that they use to help to recommend their support staff in making certain decisions. They have an ethical AI and data strategy, and they're looking at developing a robot automation plan, which provides indicators of use while robots control their traceability and ensuring correct adaptations to the changing environments. London. London is using a guide to help explain the decisions that it makes for its citizens. They have a project that brings together multiple large-scale and heterogeneous data sets. Now, that brings together mobility, transportation, and traffic activity to better understand you know, all that busyness and the opportunities to create early warning systems and so forth. Very interesting project. Espoo. Espoo is near Helsinki. It's to the west. And it is one of the intelligent communities of the year. They have developed strategies that will help to reach their UN Sustainable Development Goals and become carbon neutral by 2030. AI will help them get there. They have a Citizens Trust through AI Transparency Initiative. They work within a triple helix-enabled environment. Triple helix means public, private, and institutional sectors coming together. And of course, it should be a quadruple helix because it also includes citizens. They have an intelligent wellness platform experiment that deals with looking at AI-enabled social, healthcare, and educational data generated by all of Espoo's citizens. They deal within a circular economy, in other words, renewable gas and power capabilities for its companies and cars. District heating, where they're looking for emission-free energy production. They look for smart solutions, and they have a living lab collaborative in Espoo, working with the Aalto University and the local schools. In Manchester, they have a transport strategy, and they're looking at ways in which they can measure impact of the social distancing of not only people in transport, but also in education. This happened during COVID and the pandemic. They have an artificial intelligence-powered traffic light pilot. Now, a lot of cities are doing this around the world, particularly as they evolve their 5G technology. But they're already doing it in Manchester and can be used as a best practice. Austin, Texas, they're using a good systems project as a way of building values-driven AI. Now, this includes the design of AI technologies that will help to create new benefits for society in terms of all the challenges that they have in Austin. They have also a Vision Zero mobility AI capability to help alleviate urban traffic problems. This would be a great best practice for communities looking to solve those particular situations. Boston, like one of the previous examples, it also is trying to protect the environment, particularly the greenery in the city. So they have a tree-tech AI-enabled digital tree inventory. Again, it uses very high-resolution VHR satellite imagery and is using machine learning to pinpoint each of these pieces of greenery in both public and in private locations. And you know, it can actually tell you the size, the shape, and the condition of these trees. The trees are extremely important as part of the sustainability of a community. Now, in the Toronto region, there are many AI examples, but I want to talk a little bit differently here. There are two examples that I'd like to point out. For instance, in New Taipei City attended the Durham region's top seven conference earlier this year. And as part of it, a delegation came to visit. And they went to a place called Venture Lab. Venture Lab is a leading technology nonprofit in this area of Ontario. And they have a program called Accelerate AI, which enables high potential and scale-ready AI startups to accelerate their growth. And you know what? It's at no expense to them. The organization has raised more than $200 million in investment capital and has created thousands of jobs. In March, they had a group from Venture Labs come to Taiwan to the Smart City Summit. And there they were able to bring from Taiwan to Venture Labs companies that will be able to benefit from the same scale-up. So there already is this Taiwan and Canada connection that's happening as a result of this particular project. They also witnessed the opportunity for robots, this particular one called the Caveras Autonomous Services, to go onto streets and identify issues from a digital twinning point of view, but also just basically to alert their decision makers on things that are problems on the street. And this was, I think, a very useful opportunity to learn a little bit more about what's happening in that area. Detroit is another city that is worth exploring. Detroit identifies loud noises via acoustic sensors. Now, this also has an issue of noise pollution, but in this case, it also helps to identify where guns might be drawn and noises from those sorts of things can be identified. Not only does it identify the type of gunfire, it identifies all different kinds of aspects of that gun for the police department and officers to be dispatched to deal with it. They also have a lot of AI companies within Detroit, so it's worth having an exploratory mission that would go to Michigan to look at AI opportunities. Los Angeles. Here's a city that is able to identify the kind of air quality that's being breathed in their community. They're using AI to predict where the weather patterns are going as well. So it's a very interesting code and algorithm that's being produced. And I would suggest that people take a look at this in a greater sense. New York. New York has an artificial intelligence, robotics, and automation commission that's responsible for how automation, AI, and other emerging technologies can be regulated. So they are developing what is called a New York AI strategy and fosters healthcare, all sorts of different opportunities for technologies and other issues to be explored. And finally, it has an automated decision systems task force that supports it. Mexico City also has an anticipatory governance strategic plan. And this is one that helps to develop ethical principles to leverage the opportunities and avoid the risks associated with public use of algorithms and automated learning in sort of not only the short but also in the long term. And this anticipated governance methodology is a series of flexible and collaborative strategies allowing governments to kind of build early the necessary capabilities for future decision making. So it's very valuable information to explore further. And of course, they're looking at other things. They have a project sidewalk for accessibility, looking at the assessment of the sidewalks and intersections for accessibility issues, but also for crowdsourcing and for other things related to that. Now, I would recommend that people take a look at Curitiba in Brazil. This is a very unique community. It's been supported by urban planners. The mayor himself was an urban planner. And they have a thing called the Pino Valley Program. Now, Curitiba has been well known for its innovation and strategic innovation capabilities. They provided tax incentives. They've developed public-private partnerships. And they have a lot of startups and innovation hubs and so forth, and use AI in terms of accelerating many of these projects. One of them is this thing called the Curitiba app, which is a mobile application that provides citizens and tourists with all sorts of information and capabilities of what's available in the Curitiba area. Now, Dubai. Dubai has invested a great deal in becoming a smart, sustainable, and resilient city. They are looking at developing Internet of Things strategies, but also are working in the pragmatic areas of mobility, like their Blue Wave AI and Dubai taxis, where they've signed partnerships to decarbonize this fleet with electric vehicles managed by AI opportunities. Dubai is also looking to develop a healthcare capability using AI, and it is looking at what is called an ethical AI toolkit. There are many capabilities with AI that people should know about. They should be able to work with it in a very transparent and ethical manner, and Dubai is developing the kind of toolkit that will help developers do that. In Hong Kong, they're working with AI data collection and robotics for early detection of emergencies that are happening in the Hong Kong area. They're also developing an AI lab that brings together the academics, scientists, entrepreneurs, and others in terms of how AI can help in innovation and create a better and more livable future for their citizens. This one's unique, Melbourne. They're using AI to help change waste disposal behavior, particularly in some of these smaller companies that are sharing waste disposal systems. They have sensors and they have AI-powered algorithms to help to filter and collate this data from cameras and elsewhere. And they're able then to help the companies learn how they can dispose of their waste better. Also, private citizens and tourists who are using these waste disposal systems, they're looking for ways that artificial intelligence can actually help to ameliorate some of the problems that are happening in the alleyways where Melbourne is famous for bringing tourists and others together. They're also using it for urban forest visualizations, digital twinning, and other things related to their urban greenery. Singapore is, of course, a smart nation, and they're using AI in terms of not only its governance framework, but they're also bringing it together to create high productivity and efficiency in a variety of areas. I would recommend you contact the officials in the smart nation of Singapore. They will give you many best practices in this area. And Woven City, Japan. This is a Toyota-based community not far from Tokyo that tries to develop an autonomous car environment that will help to create a non-polluting green mobility in their community so that it helps to create a much more livable city. They're using AI in terms of their digital twinning and in creating other things that that the sensors in that community will help to create on a more livable city perspective. And finally, Masdar City, UAE, is also a community that's under development. It's a partnership of the city, local university that deals with artificial intelligence, and the private sector. They develop artificial intelligence-based clean tech, various smart city technologies, including autonomous transportation, and many other new ideas and innovation that will be able to present itself in the UAE area. So thank you for allowing me to come and be part of this particular event here in New Taipei City. It's been a wonderful opportunity to talk about AI and how it helps to accelerate the sustainability of your city. I also want to invite you to New Taipei City in 2024, where we will be involved with announcing the top seven intelligent communities for 2024. It will be in New Taipei City in June 2024. Please come and learn all about not only New Taipei City, but some of the world's best smart cities and intelligent communities. Thank you.
好，我们非常谢谢 ICF 的主席 John 为我们带来的分享。那接下来呢，我们要欢迎的是来自我们印度塔塔顾问服务的台湾区董事长马凯萨，要为我们进行下一阶段的分享。And right now, we'd like to welcome the country head of TCS Taiwan, Mr. Kati Madhavan. Welcome.
Thank you, Rebecca. And it's a pleasure. It's a pleasure to be for this forum and talk to you about how AI is very important to a smart, sustainable city. We all keep talking about AI and how it affects the smart city concepts. So we've spoken more about this, and I will touch very quickly on some of the topics. Technology is not necessarily for technology's sake. Technology is for the benefit of humanity and for people. So one of the key things that in a smart city that is very important is that the institutional infrastructure, the physical infrastructure, the social infrastructure, and the economic infrastructure all have to play together so that this gives the benefit of a sustainable smart city, which actually ensures that there is economic progress, there is environmental sustainability, and there is social development across formats. So that's very important for any smart city to be sustainable. Most of the times, what happens is you invest a lot in technology, but you forget the other pillars that are required to make a city sustainable and smart. So most of the things that we capture here, and I think other speakers have spoken about this, on green buildings, on waste management, on sustainable transportation, all these are pillars of a sustainable smart city. And what we are here to discuss is how does AI and technology form a fundamental base so that all these functions can actually start working towards a sustainable smart city. All right, this is something which is very clear, and you'll understand that any sustainable smart city that we talk about today, especially in the fundamental constructs of, say, an ESG, we talk about energy savings, we talk about reduced air pollution, we talk about improved air quality, but very, very important is, you know, prevention of infrastructure failures. Many of the times, I think where AI will fundamentally play a huge role is in terms of prevention of infrastructure failures going forward. We have seen many places where there has been power outages, there have been system outages. I think AI will play a very, very important part in making sure that there is 1:1 and real-time prevention of infrastructure failures going forward. Of course, enhanced security and optimized mobility is going to be fundamental constructs of a sustainable smart city. So this is something that will be very interesting. Across the world, pretty much when the initial technology about 1970s and 1980s, when technologies were coming into the world, there was a lion's share taken by the Western countries. But you will find that in smart city market size, you'll find that APAC, Asia Pacific, Middle East, Latin America, Europe is fast catching up, and there's pretty much North America, Asia Pacific, and Europe are pretty much equally divided, of course, with North America playing a very, very important lead role. But I think Asia Pacific is expected to witness a huge amount of growth, primarily because there's a lot of population growth happening in Asia Pacific. There's a lot of investment happening in Asia Pacific. And Asia Pacific fundamentally caters to probably about half of the world's GDP going forward in the next 20, 30 years. This is a pretty much good example of how the smart city framework finally works. You have machine learning, you have natural language processing coming into AI. You have speech recognition, which comes into AI. There's a lot of technology development going into vision-related AI. In terms of speech recognition, it's fairly matured, but we are also getting into a lot of video-based AI, which is going to enhance the level of output that's going to come for the results. And of course, you are going to put in a layer of robotics built over some expert systems. So this diagram will give you a very quick example of how the entire smart city layers work. So the entire artificial intelligence layer will come as a foundation to all the functional layers that can be built on top of this. So for example, you have education, you have healthcare, you have energy, you have agriculture and irrigation systems that the previous speakers were talking about. You have privacy and security, which is going to be very important going forward, and mobility and transportation and risk management and disaster management. So all these fundamental functions, different functions of a smart city, is built on a layer of artificial intelligence, which is going to be the common layer across, right? So this will give a very brief idea, and the presentation is going to be uploaded on the internet, so you can go through it in detail. But the fundamental construct of the AI is going to be an advanced security surveillance system. There's going to be autonomous flying objects in the future. You're already talking about drones and drone technology. There's going to be face detection, which is primarily very, very common today. A smart waste management system is going to be very, very important for a sustainable smart city. urban centers today have a very, very huge problem in terms of waste management. And I think AI will play a very important and critical role in how do we address waste management and how do we actually get the best recycling done. And of course, better governance and planning systems. So this is a very interesting, and the last few slides, this is a very interesting hype cycle that is talked by Gartner. So any technology which comes, whether it's an iPhone, whether it's a new phone, or whether it's a new technology, there's a lot of hype and interest created initially. But what happens is generally after the initial trials, which has also happened in smart city. Smart city as a concept has been around for the last 10 years, 15 years. But every time that a new project comes across countries, you can name it, whether it's in Asia, whether it's in Europe, whether it's in the US, many smart city projects have gone through its own cycles of initial failures. So what effectively happens is once the hype is created, you find a lot of disinterest because you find that the technology actually doesn't help work. But what's important is once we start learning from the failures, it's very important that we learn from the systems that fail. And it's not necessarily that technology fails, it's sometimes people don't know how to use that technology for human benefit. So most of the time, this is what happens. You'll find that the interest dips, but then after there is a shared mobility and there is a good learning in terms of how we learn from these, we actually start modeling the technology better to serve our purpose. So right now, there is a slope of enlightenment, which is a nice word they use, that we find that you get enlightened with the failures of technology and you start working on it to make it better. I think we are today in this cycle where we are in the slope of enlightenment, and I think AI will play a very, very strong role in trying to address how we can actually make smart cities smarter, right? So that's all I have, and I thank New Taipei City and Taiwan government for giving me this opportunity. There's a lot that we can do to make us better and humanity better. Thank you. Thank you, Rebecca.
Thank you so much, Mr. Cardi Madhavan, for your informative presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
那我们接下来呢，马上就要欢迎我们下一位讲师，是台湾微软的首席技术长花凯龙。我们的花首席技术长要来到我们现场，所以现在我们也一起欢迎我们的花凯龙首席技术长。
好，那个各位观众大家好，好，那今天我们代表很高兴能够代表微软来跟大家介绍这个 AI 趋势科技的一些状态。那今天的分享呢，我想我们从近期的一些这个统计的数字来跟大家做一个开场。那我们从去年年底这个 ChatGPT 开始公开的使用来说，五天的使用者他就来到了100万的用户，那两个多月的时间，全球的使用者就到了1亿的用户。那如果我们来看在这个几个大型的研究机构的这些流行趋势的分析，我们也看到了说在2028年 AI 预估会到达63个 billion 的美金。好，那其实在2033年的时候它还会再 double， 大概会达到130 billion 的一个状态。那所以这个趋势是很清楚的，我们可以看到说生成式 AI 在这个时间点未来的五年十年之内都会创造非常高的一个效益。那在我们如果再看更久来说，好，从这整个历史的事件来看，从这个西元一千年到西元1600-1700年的时间点，全球的 GDP 的成长大概是一个线性的一个关系。那陆陆续续到16、17世纪之后，随着这个科技各个的发展，它就变成了一种指数型的成长。所以你可以看到在这个我们分享的投影片里面，到17世纪之后，整个科技带动的经济成长是一个非常快速的状态。那以近期来说 ，AI 带领的这一波潮流，尤其是生成式 AI， 从去年的开始，我们会看到的是整个经济的走势会有一个更快速、更加速成长的一个状态。 那人工智慧的技术其实已经不是一个新的技术了，我们从1956年陆陆续续到2012年一个很重要的 milestone， 深度学习的技术的发展。好，那陆陆续续在AI 的世界里面就有很多新的斩获。那透过2012年深度学习这样一个新的技术的发展的时候，其实我们可以从我们的生活中可以感受到的是，大概在2012年个这样的深度类神经网络的技术在围棋的应用上面 AlphaGo 里面，我们其实有看到说这个人工智慧开始可以击败人类在下围棋的这样的一个比赛。那陆陆续续这个深度学习的技术呢持续的演进，好，那到了2014年有这个深层对抗网络，到了2021年2023年陆陆续续又有更进阶的这个深层式的人工智慧的技术来发展。那在这样的技术里面呢，我们用这样的一个示意图，好，来跟大家来做一个分享。好，比如说在左边这个例子里面，我们给这个人工智慧一个基本的指令，我们跟他说，你可不可以用深层式的人工智慧帮我写一首新诗？好，那在左边的例子里面，他就很快的得到了一个诗的写出了一首诗。那在中间这个例子里面呢？我们请他跟他，我们跟这个人工智慧说，好，你可不可以用莫内的 style 帮我画一幅画？那这幅画的内容，我们希望是一个人跟一个机器人在下棋的样子。那大概也花了30秒的时间，好，那这个人工智慧就很快速的画出了这幅画。那你可以想象，以前我们在做人工智慧的这些对应的这个互动的时候，我们需要有专业的科学家或工程师来做这个资讯的辅助，但是在现在这个时间点，其实已经是一个很大的转变，它的门槛变得很低，我们可以用一般说话的方式就可以跟这个人工智慧来做沟通，那也可以透过基本的沟通的方式就得到了一个蛮好的结果。其实写新诗跟画画对一般人来说门槛其实都蛮高的，可是在现有的技术里面，它可以协助我们在一个低的门槛就得到了这样的一个成果。那回到一个 high level 的技术的分享，好，在现在的新的人工智慧生成式的人工智慧的技术里面，其实它算是一个，我们以前谈人工智慧，现在其实还会再延伸一点说人工通用智慧，不只是基础的人工智慧，而且它有一个通用的概念在这里面。那我们中间这个示意图是要跟大家分享，就是说这个模型啊，其实它非常的复杂，它是一个很复杂的类神经网络。那如果以譬喻的模式来跟大家解释，它就像是一个大学生的大脑。那这个大学生的大脑呢，它在训练的过程之中，其实就像左边，我们会给它很多的训练的资讯，透过网络上的这些资讯，透过了这个Wikipedia 的资讯，透过了电子书各种的资讯，当做它的训练的资料。那以一个想象的模式来说，你可以想说，哎，这个大学生他进了一个大学，那参加了一个不分系的 program， 那这个 program 里面他有英文课，他有日文课，他有电脑的课程，他有这个财经的课程、法律的课程、医学的课程，所以这个不分系的学生呢，他在大学的期间他把所有系的这个必修选修都上完了。那上完这些课跟我们不太一样的是他不会忘记，好，所以他学了这么多的东西也记在他的脑袋里面。那这时候他毕业了，好，那毕业的时候呢，他其实就具备了这样一个人工通用智能的一个基础，他学了这么多东西然后融会贯通之后，他就站在一个蛮高的一个基础上面。所以有时候我们会说他是一个 foundation model，但是这个 foundation 呢其实是很高的，不是我们想象的是一楼的 foundation， 这个 foundation 其实它的能力，就像我们站在101的屋顶上面的概念，它会画画，它会写诗，它还可以这个看得懂文言文，那它会英文、会日文、会西班牙文，各种语言的掌握度都很高。那当我们要做客制化的处理的时候，好，那我们就类似会送他去念一个研究所，比如说我们希望他在金融的领域能够发挥一些所长，那我们就会给他一些金融相关的资料，让他做一些客制化的服务。那如果我们希望他成为一个更好的软体工程师，我们就会给他相关的对应的这些程式的资料，让他在程式的撰写上面有一个更理想的一个成果。 好，那微软呢，从2019年开始，我们其实就跟这个 OpenAI 有一个很好的一个合作的关系。那从2019年到2023年，微软投资这个 OpenAI 这间公司大概已经到达了130亿美金。好，那在这个投资案里面， OpenAI 把它相关的这些训练出来的模型就独家授权给了微软。那这个模型里面我们可以有一些基本的功能，好，比如说我们在做 Semantic Search，或者是这些文字上面的这个理解，或者是在做 summarization 内容的生成，都是它基础的一些功能。那在短短半年多的时间点，那微软已经把这些能力整合到了全系列的微软的产品里面，包含了 Office 的系列，这个 Windows 系列，或者是 Bing Search 相关的这些整合进去了。那除了这样的整合之外呢，因为微软本身在这个云端的平台已经有非常久远的经验，所以我们在资安这个合规，好，那或者是 data privacy 还有 responsible AI 这几个面向都已经有非常长远的这些规划跟一些成果。那所以呢，把这样 OpenAI 的这个功能连接到了微软 Azure 的平台上面，好，我们就提供了一个更安全合规的一个服务。那微软在人工智慧的这个领域呢，其实我们已经发展了将近有十年多以上的历史。那所以我们把生成式的 AI 回到跟连接回到我们之前持续以来发展的这个分析式的 AI 做了一个连接跟统合的关系。所以在这个时间点呢，我们其实就整合了这个分析式的 AI 跟生成式的 AI 来达到一个这个纵向的效果，好，可以透过这两种 AI 的能力来提供更多的这些服务。那在这个现在的这个时间点，好，我们可以有了这样 GPT 的能力之后啊，新的 platform 新的整个平台的转换，好，其实就如同下面这张图的概念，我们可以透过自然语言，因为它可以读懂我们想要跟它沟通的方式。以前我们在做资料输入的时候都要有特定的格式，但是在这个时间点，其实只要我们会讲话，我们就可以透过一般讲话的模式来跟这个人工智慧做沟通。那跟它沟通的同时呢，它中间就有一个很复杂的像大学生的大脑，可以来协助我们不管是做分析或是做内容文字的生成。那在这样的一个模型之下，好，我们可以看到说就像如同我们一开始提到的，它从 各个新闻百科论文网络的文章收取到了这些资讯里面，那进到了这个大脑之后呢，我们可以透过这个大脑来完成很多的任务，好，比如说生成文字，生成写程式，生成图片，或者是在语义的搜寻。那这些应用里面它就可以对应到很多其他延伸的应用，包含了我们可以在 center, call center 的部分，可以让这个客户的这些互动的过程之中都记录下来，也可以有一个互动的 report。 那我们也可以让自然语言的这个数据的管理，好，透过自然语言的沟通的方式跟我们的 database 来进行一个快速容易的互动的方式。那我们把这个 OpenAI 整合到了 Azure 里面，我们可以广泛应用在各种商业的流程当中。那如同我们刚刚说的，我们第一个可以在这个创意的方向，好，在文案的撰写里面，我们可能有一些初步的想象，那我们就可以透过 GPT 的方式帮我们延伸我们的想象的这些机会出去。那另外呢，我们在翻译的部分，好，我们也可以，其实我们如果来想象，如果有一个小朋友，他的父母假设一个来自于这个美国，一个来自于台湾，那我们对这个小朋友的期待就是他在一个双语的世界长大，所以他英文跟中文都很好。那在 GPT 的世界里面，你可以想象他像是有100个爸爸100个妈妈，而且每个人都讲不同的语言，所以他有了这样的一个训练的 data，其实他在每一个语言的掌握度都很高，他会讲中文，会讲英文，会讲西班牙文，会讲日文，会讲俄文，所以他在翻译的这个能力上面其实都回到是一个 native speaker 可以来做这样的一个翻译的能力。那摘要的总结，他对文字的了解其实掌握度也很高，所以他可以快速的协助我们把一个比较大比较长的一个文章那收敛成一个比较精简摘要的一个内容。 那我们也可以针对知识库的搜寻，一般的 database 很多公司里面都有一个KM 系统，有一个知识管理系统。那一般的知识管理系统，我们要去搜寻出来我们要的资料，其实也不是这么样的容易。那但是透过 GPT 的这样的理解的能力，我们可以快速的找到我们想要得到的这些资讯。那还可以延伸到这个 operation 端，针对服务机器人，其实我们就可以连接不同的 operation， 透过 GPT 的能力把它整合在一起。那还可以针对舆情的分析，那这舆情的分析又包含了，因为它懂各国语言，所以它可以在各国语言的平台上面一起来收敛它对应想要得到的这些资讯。那新闻薪资的部分，还有在这个商业流程的部分，也都是它延伸可以得到的对应的这些应用里面。那微软呢，我们刚刚有提到的是说，在这半年的时间点里面，我们把 GPT 这样一个大型语言模型跟微软本身这个商务数据的能力，那结合了我们本身的产品应用的程式，好，那有很多的一些连接的成果。那所以呢，我们很快的跟大家分享一个影片。那在这个影片里面，其实我们有看到的是说整合了 GPT 的能力到了 Office 的系列，那我们可以从 Word file， 那就请它快速的帮我们就生成一个 PowerPoint。 好，那以前大家做简报很辛苦，在未来的这个Office 系列整合了 GPT 的能力之后，它可以快速的产生一个版本。那同时除了这个投影片的生成之外，好，那我们刚刚也看到了，在 Excel， 我们一般来说 Excel 只是在做一些表单的填写，但是呢，其实 Excel 它本身具备了非常多的进阶的一些分析的能力。那可以透过 GPT 的能力呢，以后比如说我们有两个财报的资讯，它就可以快速的帮我们协助在这个两个表格里面找到一些 business 的 insight。好，那接着我们来针对这个多国语言的部分，好，也很快的给大家分享。
谢谢大家
分享。
拨空参与今天的技术交流会，
好，你可以看到的是说，这个 Avatar 它的嘴巴呢，
技术与政府应用分享
的
一程，很高兴为大家分享了 OpenAI 和 Azure。谢谢大家拨空参与今天的技术交流会，在 Azure OpenAI 划世代技术与政府应用分享的一程。很高兴为大家分享了 OpenAI 和 Azure OpenAI Service 的不同。
好，那所以你可以看到说，这个 Avatar 的生成啊，
Codex 和
道理
三种模型
的
应用场景和行业扶持应用情境探讨。
各种模式，
若大家有任何问题，都欢迎随时跟我们联络。再次感谢。
换成英文。
Thank you for participating in today's technical exchange meeting.
所以在这个语言上面的处理，其实它可以协助快速的用不同的语言来产出它的这些结果。好，那另外我们这个接着的这个例子要跟大家分享的是说，在跨不同的应用里面，我们透过 Teams 的一个应用，好，怎么样从不同的这个Word、PowerPoint 相关的应用里面来做连接的成果。所以比如说像在这个例子里面，我们今天到办公室就问 Teams 说，我们有什么要注意的事情，今天公司有什么要处理的事情。 那我们就从我们的我们就从我们昨天的会议记录，从你的 Outlook 的 email， 从你的 PowerPoint， 你就快速的，他就 GPT 去帮你读，好，说昨天你的会议记录有哪些，你做了哪些 PowerPoint， 你的 Outlook 有怎么样跟客户之间的一些沟通，那就提醒你说，哎，那这些是你昨天跟这个客户之间的一些互动的状态。那所以你今天呢有一些要注意的事情，好，比如说，哎，有一些要 follow up 的事情，有一些要跟这个客户开这个讨论的事项，这个 lead time 要去做一些追踪的状态，好，所以还有另外是说，比如说我们在这个例子里面，我们要跟 Mona 有一个 meeting， 那他就会提醒你说，哦，那跟 Mona 的 meeting 有哪些是你接着要 follow up 的部分。那你可以看到说他后面还有一个对应的那个 citation 那个数字，所以他也会告诉你说，哎，他为什么给你这个建议，后面有那个1234的数字，你又可以连接到他对应的这个软体过去。好，那在微软整个的平台来说，整个 Azure Open AI 的 service 来说，我们可以做的应用的服务非常非常的多，好，那包含了说我们刚提到的优化民众的服务体验，我们也可以来做优化的后台的管理，那我们有行政流程的自动化跟营运的自动化，好，所以在整个应用来说，其实我们不管是全球或是在这个台湾的这个部分，我们已经针对各行各业都协助大家在做更自动化的这些处理，好，那从政府的效能的提升到其实最近我们也跟医院有一些合作，好，这护士的缺工怎么样协助护士在更短的时间可以 onboarding， 那也可以连接到他的这个KM 的系统，都是一个非常重要的我们持续在协助的状态。好，那最后呢，我想以几个重要的这个 keyword 来跟大家做一个分享。好，那微软在人工智慧的这个历程里面，其实我们做了非常多的努力。那我们的老板呢，其实跟大家分享，其实 Office、 Windows 都是大家对微软最熟悉的这些产品，那到了这个手机的时代，其实是微软一个辛苦的挑战啦，因为你可以看到说我们其实要现在如果你要买一个 Windows 版本的手机好像不是这么的容易，可是呢 Satya 针对了这样的一个挑战，我们从云端的转型到 AI 的转型都做得很成功，那老板其实常常给我们很多的期待，那今天就以这一句话来跟大家分享，那要持续的有热情，要勇敢，那在这个科技变化很快的时代，我们要持续热情有勇气，那持续的学习，我们就可以一起表现得很好。好，那今天分享到这边，谢谢。
好，我们谢谢台湾微软的首席技术长，我们的花凯龙花技术长，为我们带来非常精彩的分享，谢谢。哇，真的是在花技术长分享之下，让我们知道了这个科技，我们的 AI 趋势科技呢，在现在的应用范围上真的非常的广泛，而且呢是不太需要很高深的技术，我们日常生活当中就可以应用的。那接下来呢，要为各位带来是我们智慧城市的创新应用。那我们邀请到的是宇智顾问的李维峰董事总经理，让我们一起掌声欢迎。
你好，大家好，就开始啊，好。非常高兴今天能来这里跟大家分享我们在智慧城市方面的创新跟应用，也非常感谢新北市政府的邀请，让我们有这个机会来发表我们一些在智慧城市上面的一些新的构想跟概念上的东西。那先介绍我自己，其实我跟大家都前面几位讲者不太一样，我并不是科技出身的，我其实是做 infrastructure 的，我本身是土木系，专门在做建造比较硬的东西，比较大型的东西。那会投入这个智慧城市，主要是因为我们在过去几年从航空城的开发到未来几个智慧社区的开发里面，我们投入了我们相当多的心血，从这个所谓的智慧的基础建设开始，然后导入的各项的功能从角色上来讲，我们比较像是 client， 比较像是这个客户在选取这个智慧城市的功能。那我们就开始今天的内容。其实如果我们先来讲述智慧城市这个产业，如果你是看智慧城市这个产业的话，其实你会看到我们把智慧城市这个产业一旦打开之后，你会发现台湾最强最有实力的这个晶圆制造只是上游端， 那另外台湾也是非常强的，这些包括 ICT AI 啦，还有能源的部分其实是中游端，但是台湾这些很强的产业，全世界排名就台湾这个护国神山这些产业，但是一直没有找到一个整合起来可以做示范的地方。其实我们在觉得在所谓的智慧城市的创新应用上，台湾需要的是一个实际可以实现的场区跟场域。那这个地方我们就开始才想说，我们是不是可以把 Smart City 当作是整合说产业的地方。那如果我们台湾能进了智慧城市这个产业的时候，做到最后一里路的时候，有一个实际的场域的时候，其实台湾在智慧城市这个全球可以几乎可以到25兆美元的这个产业这个25兆美元产业里面，我们可以占到很大的一个角色，甚至可以再扮演最主要的角色。那所以我们也希望是说，从这个晶圆的采购晶圆的制造，一直开发到变成智慧社区的一个建造，然后最后可以复制这样子一个智慧社区的建造到全世界去，那变成台湾新一代的一个智慧的一个产业的旗舰。那从这边开始，我们就来看哪些东西是我们在智慧城市里面我们希望去强调的创新应用。第一个 business model。很多人大概现在还是在卖智慧的功能、智慧的仪器、智慧的电感，但是没有人想到那怎么样赚最大的钱。第二个是 content， 智慧城市我们希望把 content 从一单一功能变成一个 lifestyle， 变成一个生活的形式。那最后我们当然希望这些东西都可以跟环境、跟这个所谓的永续结合在一起。那所以从现在开始我们就开始讲过我们整个一个开发的历程跟整个推展的一个历程。其实在远在2012年台湾就其实有了第一个智慧城市的计划，那就是桃园航空城计划。那时候我们就想要建造一个新的智慧城市。桃园 Aerotropolis， 在那个阶段其实刚好台湾有这个机会把4600多公顷的一个土地全部打造成一个新的生活机能的区域，那可以全部把等于是把所有的东西打掉，那重新做基础建设。那在那部分我们其实做了一个很完整的配置。其实我在想，当你要做一个智慧城市或智慧社区的时候，最重要的就是要配置，这个 planning 跟这个layout 是最重要的，因为它你会关系到你未来引进的功能跟未来的想法。在那一个计划里面，其实我们就开展了很多的一些包括智慧的功能、住宅的功能以及永续的功能，包括这个绿地的留存，包括道路的这个智慧化，包括运输的智慧化，以及包括整个生活形态的永续韧性。那因为时间的关系，我把让大家只是看一下这个我们当初的规划构想。那再下来，在那时候我们也确认了这个智慧城市的开发发展的一个路径图，这个 roadmap。 其实我们把它分成四大项，就一个广大型的社区来讲，大型的城市来讲，第一个是这个所谓的economy 的 business， 你一定要有一个商业行为。那另外我们下一个就是做所谓的生活的 information， 就是情报资讯的流通。那过来才是整个基础建设的需求的列项，然后最后才是到作为所谓的政府的服务。那这样子在那时候我们就定了一些开发的方向跟层级。那一样开发还是要有一个顺序，所以想法上我们就需要从最小的一个点，可能是一个车站，可能是一个广场，也可能是一个 block， 一个公园，到一个区域。那整个区域有可能是一个青浦区，也有可能是一个商业区，也可能是一个住宅区，到最后到整个航空城的一个区域的发展。那一样在这个过程中，政府没有那么多的预算，你要如何引进民间的资源，如何架构把所有的公司的私有化、营运公司的私有化，也需要很聪明的一个架构。所以 Smart City 不止 City 要 Smart， 在 Operational 的 Framework 上也要非常的 Smart。 那但是很可惜的，那时候的整个计划到执行的时候，因为选举的关系、政治的关系、政党轮替的关系，就没有再继续执行下去。后来我们发现要做一个大城市的智慧化真的很难，所以我们想到说，可不可以缩小，把它缩小成一个 社区来先试试看。那也很好玩的，我们在2021年宇智顾问刚好有这个机会参与了台积电的这个一些供应链的到美国凤凰城的发展的规划，我们就想到说，如果我们能不能在那里开发一个智慧社区，让所有的台积电的员工是住在一个拥有让使用晶片赋予的智慧功能所变成的一个智慧社区，那这个是我们当地的一个景色。我们在那里找了一块140大概60几公顷的一个土地，然后它面有湖，赋予了我们永续发展的一个内容。那另外我们也在那里准备把台湾的这些产业的台湾的智慧城市产业的各项功能带到那里做一个整合。那在那开发的内容里面，我们包括了800户的住宅，也包括了湖边的湖畔的一个五星级的饭店，也有社区活动中心，里面是多功能的社区活动中心，给予很多智慧的功能。另外我们也从房型，从这个公寓型的一直到独栋的湖边的这个豪宅，我们都有在做规划。在规划上也给予了很多巧思，包括如何与自然环境结合，如何适应当地的日照，如何适应当地的风的吹动，让整个温度流通，甚至我们在里面的规划都考量到很多跟湖、跟人，还有跟整个生态公园的一个沟通跟这个行为的互动等等。那我们怎么去做这件事情，要把什么东西放进去？所以我们希望是我们规划的是从生活形态的规划来进入整个设计的内容。那我们列出了九大项的这个智慧永续的功能，每一项都有我们的想法，包括智慧的服务，在那边你可以透过你的这个穿戴装置，就可以说我今天要预留这个球场，还是想要先把我的家里的冷气先调开来。那这些东西其实就慢慢跟今天的主题也非常相关，很多东西都在必须在现在规划的时候就把 AI 的功能跟 AI 的演算法则赋予到每一项的 service 里面去，包括smart home， 包括住宅内的这些温度的调控，什么像是最适的调控，什么时候开冷气，什么时候可以把温度调降。那甚至在运输方面，是不是有无人载具啊，还是说有这些自驾车在里面做一些 service， 购物等等的 service， 也包括当然最基本的智慧的环安卫，那也包括温度的控制，看能不能利用湖水来调节整个环境的温度，让环境可以比外面在夏天的时候是低个两度，在冬天的时候是高个两度。那也做到所谓的韧性防灾，就是它的我们有绿色的能源跟市电做一个结合，它的用电永远不会缺乏，我们有湖水跟我们的使用的水再回收，让它的用水无欲缺乏也可以适应各种的灾害。那也做所谓的各种的回收，包括废弃物的回收，包括这个所谓的水的回收、中水的回收、下水的回收。更重要，在我们在建造的过程中，我们也会用很多的回收材料来充分体现这个永续的价值。那绿能当然是最重要的一部分。亚利桑那州的太阳很大，所以我们在绿能的方面，从发电到电网到储能到充电，到最后的能源管理系统，我们都有做了充足的准备。最后把所有东西都整合起来的时候，我们需要的就是所谓的 AI 的 Smart Service。 我想这个就是在其实 AI 的生成过程中，它的服务的生成过程中需要大量的资料。那当一个社区里面生活的行为的资料，还有用电的资料、能源的资料，甚至所谓的服务功能的资料、商业行为的资料等等，都会让它回馈到 AI 的 service 里面去。那在文化的部分也是非常重要，我们也把很多印第安的遗迹给保留下来，变成两个文化公园。那也做所谓的重要在所谓 AI 平台里面最重要的一个功能，就是要做一个 digital twins。 digital twin 的意思就是说，我要把整个计划有一个 model， 不管在我规划的时候就开始在数值模型上面做规划讨论，甚至在未来的运行的阶段，我会用数值模型去反馈我能源的使用耗能的阶段跟整个民众可能社区民众使用的状况。那这是我们已经开始逐步的在制作的这个数值模型。那最后当然讲到永续，如何把这些从文化、环境、清净能源、再生利用、循环经济、水啊，甚至到运动休闲等等，把它变成永续的发展。这包括了古迹文化公园，也包括了这个所谓微气候的调节，也包括了循环，也包括了循环再利用，也包括了用水。那最后当然是我们在整个开发的过程中，把这个占地七十几个 acre， 大概是三十几公顷的湖跟生态公园全完全保留了下来，它就是一个最有价值的永续资产。那我们也开始架构了怎么样去做这样子的一个方式，从底层的这个基础建设，到所谓的 sensor 层，到感知层，到了应用层，应用就是不同的 service 的应用，到了所谓的我们的目标永续净零碳排的城市，以及这个所谓的韧性城市。那这样子在整合上，我们也有一个管理中心来做，那它的 roadmap 也可以就产生的出来。从第一轮的这所谓的基础建设，包括了通讯，包括了所谓的运输，包括了生活这个生命线，那也包括了当然我们刚才讲的 digital twin 可以使用的这个设计跟规划的平台，到了能源，我们刚才已经讲过，从能源的整个系统，也包括了这个社区的管理系统，包括home smart home smart building， 到 AI 的 service， 到最后的永续发展，包括了这个绿色的永续资产，包括了回收再利用，包括人的跟环境的一个交流。那但是怎么赚钱啊？这个东西就要变成是不能就我有这个理想，那我们的赚钱的方法就是架构一个可以非常 smart 的投资的模式，然后去做这样子的赚钱，那变成一个可以生产产出大家共会做永续，真做这个智慧，不能只有一直卖仪器啊，卖这个东西，我们希望是能产出共同的价值出来。那另外在最后，我们在最近也跟台湾的农委会农业部部长做了一个新的一个计划。刚才我们所讲的这样子的一个智慧社区的概念，能不能投入到台湾的农村里面去？农村也就是一个社区，那社区我们更好的想法也是一样，从基础建设、感知到应用，到所谓的这些永续发展啊，或是韧性发展。那我们的想法是这样，可能一个农村最主要的大型的农村是集中的中心，管理的中心，旁边不同的农村会负责不同的智慧功能或永续功能，然后他们就会组合成一个群聚的效应，变成一个smart village 的 clusters。那这样子的一个做法非常适合台湾的发展，那各取这样一个小型的这样子的模组圈，他们就可以互相供应各种需求，也可以提供各种智慧的功能。那这样子的东西其实政府要怎么做，因为不可能由民间出钱去做，所以政府的做法我们也提出了用 PFI 就 Private Financial Initiative 的一个做法。它的做法很简单，政府由民间厂商先出钱，把这些社区啊，把这些农村的智慧功能先建造起来。政府利用每年的政府利用每年的付款的形式，让它可以去付款。那厂商在建造的时候，它可以先做所谓像跟银行做或是金融机构做融资。那这样子来进行的时候，其实厂商也愿意有资源、有费用、有预算可以投入。政府再利用逐年编列的预算去付这些厂商所提供的这些 service， 那这个民众也可以得到这样子的一个服务的功能。这是我们的一个架构。那原则上就希望是由所谓的智慧城市、智慧社区的厂商组成一个consortium， 就是一个 这个所谓的建造团队，那建造团队也包括未来的运营，那利用这个 PPP 的模式，利用这个所谓的 PFI 的模式，然后永续的经营下去，这是我们对智慧城市的一个智慧农村，把刚才所讲的智慧社区延伸到智慧农村的一个做法。那最后也是这个结论，我想人家这今天的标题是智慧城市的创新运用。那我觉得智慧城市的创新运用缺少的是什么？缺少的是business model， 缺少的是lifestyle， 怎么样把 lifestyle 引进？缺少的是怎么跟永续的结合？我们今天介绍的几个案例，其实是把这几件事情实际上做到，也提出了他们可行的方案也跟大家分享参考，谢谢。
好，我们谢谢吕月峰董事总经理为我们所做的介绍，谢谢。
谢谢。
哇，我们真的非常开心，今天呢，在我们的这个International Smart City Forum 当中呢，我们有非常多来自国际的专家跟我们用经验的分享的方式呢，来跟我们讲到国际上一些智慧城市的治理，还有呢，如何在永续发展的这个面向呢，有怎么样的政策，那也可以让我们来做借鉴。那刚刚在下午的场次呢，也有四位专家和我们分享了 AI 趋势科技的应用，还有呢一些这个在智慧城市的创新应用层面。所以希望大家今天在线上都有满满的收获，也希望呢各位刚刚都有没有参加我们的这个线上抽奖的活动。那希望大家经过了今天下午的论坛之后呢，可以跟着我们一起迈向智慧永续的城市愿景。那我们今天2023新北市智慧城市国际论坛到这边就圆满完成，希望大家平安顺心。那我们明年再见。Thank you all for joining us here today at the 2023 NTPC International Smart City Forum. Hope to see you next year and have a wonderful day. Thank you.